we're gonna do a call and response. I'm gonna call, and you're gonna respond. I'm gonna count you in, though. It's a little sneak attack. So I'm gonna count you in, and if you get lost, just follow the choir, the sexy, cute church choir. Let's give them a round of applause. Okay, here we go. Everybody say love, two, four.
Love!
Everybody say love.
Love!
Everybody say love.
Love!
Love.
Love!
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 Love! Our church team to you. Three of them just left the stage. I wanted them to be up here so you could see them, but anyway, there they are. If you can stand up, we'll introduce you. The luscious lady in the very back is Lady Dee Dee, everyone. One of our favorite cabaret performers in New York City, it is Mercedes Herman. And our preacher for the day, our integral mentor, and my wonderful husband, Reverend Glenn Gannon.
Glenn, you're here!
All right, let me introduce you to the players. Over here, recording artist, producer, vocalist, pianist, and our music director, Philip Carroll! A new friend of ours on our Church of Shooting Minimum Teen. I love this woman, our percussionist, Robin Daniel. And of course, bringing the sexy riot into the church atmosphere and queering it up, our Tranimal musician, singer, songwriter, ladies and gentlemen, Feathers the Wise. And everybody that is a cabaret person knows the voice of the amazing Carly Ozard Alada. The unwise. No, I don't think so. All right, we have landed. Let's take a deep breath together, shall we? Yeah, let's do that one more time. Just one more time for Molly, if you don't mind. Feels so good. So what are we? What in the world is church with a two-drink minimum? Well, it is God-optional, interspiritual, and interfaith. Now, what in the world does that mean? What does that mean? I mean, really, come on now. Well, what it really, really means is our religion is love and our spiritual practice is kindness. So with that in mind, why don't you turn around to your neighbor and say, howdy, cousin, I'm so glad to see ya.
Howdy, cousin.
Glad you're here. Howdy,
cousin.
Since last we were at Sidewalk Cafe, I realized that I needed bifocals. Do any of y'all wear bifocals around here? I know, sometimes you can't see, right? So, today... Just want to check, make sure I was in the right key. So, now, wow, look at all this green, all this wonderful green. We know it's St. Patty's Day, but we are reframing it today as Interfaith Sunday because we love our Irish friends. My family is part Irish. But we also know that that particular celebration is about driving the snakes out of Ireland. And those snakes happen to be druids, and so we celebrate our wonderful druid family. in honor of the snakes, I wear these shoes. So, in this circle of love that we are creating consciously together, I want to include the Lenape. The Lenape are the original people of New York, and we are seated right now on what was once Lenape territory. So we give honors and blessings to the Lenape. Aho.
Aho.
In this circle of love that we are creating, we extend our energies out into this beautiful day in our beautiful city that where people are partying. Yes, it's so good. We extend that so that parties are good. That's why we have church for the 15 minutes. So we extend that circle of love out into this city and even farther out into the state and even farther out into our country and even farther out into our world. And in this circle of love, we welcome all, those we like and those we don't like. And in this circle of love, we begin to come to know our inner teacher, our inner Wahe Guru. Wahe Guru Ji Kal Kalsa, Wahe Guru Ji Ki Fate Fate, Wahe Guru Ji Kal Kalsa, Wahe Guru Ji Ki Fate Fate, Wahe Guru Ji Kal Kalsa, Wahe Guru Ji Ki Fate Fate, Wahe Guru Ji Kal Kalsa, Wahe Guru Ji Ki Fate Fate. Why do Guruji keep a kifate. Wahoo guruji kao kao sa. Wahoo guruji kifate fate. Wahoo guruji kao kao sa. Wahoo guruji kifate fate. Kate,
Kate. She's my favorite, and so I like to call her Kate, Kate. So, many of you have come to Church with Two Drink Minimum. We really thank you for being here, and you know that we have a variety of offerings to offer you today. So, up on our offering list is the Storyteller Goddess. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Mercedes Herman.
Greetings and love to everyone. And I love it when Sister Yolanda and Reverend Glenn tell me the idea is going to be about interfaith. So I always, you know, look for a story to find something that's really going to be catchy. But I thought about it, the fact that I have a new lover.
A new lover?
Yes, a lover.
Oh.
you saw how everybody got like, whoa. We like to write to each other a lot. And we like to write love letters. And he likes my love letters a lot. He says that I expand his mind. And he says I see things very differently than what he would have thought of. But one of the things that, in order for him to be my muse, I said, tell me a song that you like. Tell me something that you would like me to learn. And if anyone knows about me and lyrics, you know, it's gonna be a long time, it's gonna be a long letter. So he said that he liked the song from Queens, something about magic. And I thought about it, and I kept looking at it, and there was a line in there that reminded me something about interfaith, because you're probably saying, well, how is this gonna work? And it's, the line is, one dream, one soul. We live in a time where people are just busy fighting each other. They're busy fighting against religions and all kinds of things. But the dream is really the one dream. As I wrote to him, I said, that one dream is that we can really figure out how is it that we want to be together. Because that's what all the thing about religion. Religion is really a man-made thing, but it's a spiritual thing. It's wondering, how is it that we can love, share, and celebrate? There are those who do not celebrate a supreme being. There are those who celebrate the Taurus or whatever. But you have a right to dream about it. Because see, sometimes we think dreams are kind of floaty, but it's a beauty. It's a kind of sense of just wanting to float there and trying to imagine. Could you imagine if you could just go up and touch love, touch someone that you loved, caress that. Because that's really what we should be doing with each other. We should be wanting to enclose ourselves. We need to know how that feels. We need to be able to say, I have a right to pray or sing or dance the way I want to. I have a right to celebrate how I want to live and what my life is all about. And then the part that, as I'm writing him, and he, I love it, he responds back, I love the flat iPad, it's just wonderful. And I love that he writes back and he says, tell me more, what about this soul? It's wonderful having a new lover, I'm telling you something. And then I talked about the fact, are we not all souls? Yeah. Are we not all a spiritual being? Because basically, if you believe in the fact that when we leave this bodily thing, our bodily function, you know, this piece of material, as I call it, we're souls. We're just floating by. But we're a basic kind of a soul. We're all trying to be together. And we're all trying to be like, oh, just to be together. That's so. We know people who are soulless. They have no feeling. They have no want. They have no desire to connect. Sometimes soulless people have a wanting to hurt. And we know how it feels to have soulless people hurt us. Right now, we face something that happened a couple of days ago. Someone who was soulless, who had no desire to honor or to respect someone how they wanted to pray. But to get away from that, that's the whole idea. And as I wrote to him and I said, you know, it has to do with the soul. And I said, you know, just think about it. How many times we're in our bed, we can feel our soul is calling and wanting to love. And then the prize. What's the prize? The prize is to be in love. And that's how we're supposed to be. We're supposed to be in love with all of each other. Mm. We're supposed to be wanting to love each other. We're supposed to want. And I use from a verse of 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the many variations of love. Because, you know, sometimes we just think love is all goody and all that. But it's not. It's loving that person, knowing that you're not going to be rude to them, knowing that you want the best for them, knowing that you can tell them the truth, knowing that you can be vulnerable and know that you're not going to be hurt. Mm. That's the prize. Mm. And there's so many people who don't want us to have that prize. But I come to tell you that no matter what your faith is, whatever your belief system is, you want that prize. You want to be connected. You want to know that when time ends, culturally, our cultural memory, that we'll be part of that universe. Because we are part of the universe. So we can decide to be soulless and float around in negative, or we can decide to have that soul. And we also can have that dream. Remember, dreams, as my mother would say, are made to happen. So I give you grace, and I ask you for your love. Yeah.
Mercedes, Mercedes Herman, everybody! Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's hot up in here! Can we have an air conditioner? Is there like anything that we can have? Or a big wind machine to blow my hair?
It's probably me, I just get sweaty up in here, you know how I am. But,
so I have a great faith in humanity. I really, really do. I know there's a lot going on. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But I want to sing a song about how much faith I have in you.
A perfect outcome to all things.
Yes, it is.
It's a sure.
Yes, it is.
Oh,
it is.
A perfect outcome.
Yes, it is.
To all things.
Yes, it is.
All things.
Yes, it is.
Sure.
Yes, it is.
hear the anger and hateful talk out on the street. Yes, I do. But I also see love in the eyes of the people I meet. We're not so different, you and I. We all just want what's best for our lives. We seem to find according to the workings of our minds. Here we go now. Every situation, there's a blessing somewhere. Come together, brothers and sisters, and see that it is there. I need you, and you need me.
I think of unity. We live in this amazing city called New York City, with all these different religions, all these different cultures, and yet sometimes none of these cultures interact. Mm. They just thrive and thrive and thrive, and they never actually bind together as one unity. Interfaith. So this is called Strength and Unity. It's called, it's by me, Lady Dee Dee, or Diamond Dee Dee Darling.
Yeah.
And let me just, you know, make my way through it. So as I said, we are not the first city, nor the last. So we're going to take you back. Once upon a time, as most stories start out. Powder, set. Are you ready?
Yes!
All right. Now how does the story start?
Once upon a time!
Thank you. In the mythical island city of Babylon, lived many communities run by elders. Each group worked harmoniously within themselves. However, they were suspicious of the other communities, and would often cause one another great strife and stress. The great queen who watched over the city would spend much of her time in the courts of law, struggling to get her citizens to understand that working together would bring prosperity to all the citizens of Babylon. Suddenly, a great earthquake shook the city, causing devastating damages to buildings and destroying the large bridge that connected the city to the mainland. The elders of the community desperately tried to rebuild, but to no avail. Their queen, they were just like, who would we turn to? Who would we turn to?
The queen.
The queen, who was wise, clearly understood the problem and presented her doves to the elders and said to the elders, watch the doves and release them from their cage. Upon releasing them, she threw out a net. Oh, maybe she turn my page for me, darling. Still suspense. Thank you. Upon releasing them, she threw out a net, and they were trapped. The doves desperately fluttered their wings, trying to get out, but to no avail. The larger doves cooed and cooed and tried to get them together, and then cooed more until they all cooed in harmony. Suddenly, each dove picked up a portion of the net, and together they flew off, carrying the net with them. The great queen said, "There is strength in unity, and let the elders go." Then, soon, the communities worked together to rebuild their city. It began to grow and thrive almost as well as it did before the earthquake. Almost. The great bridge that connected the city of Babylon to the rest of the cities was quite destroyed. And no one in the island city, could figure out how to fix it. So again, they turned to
the queen.
They went back to the queen and they said, "What shall we do about this?" And once again, she presented her doves. This time, however, as the doves flew away, she instructed the elders to follow them until they landed. Upon landing near a tree, the doves cooed until a mouse appeared. The mouse was so happy to see friends, saw the net, and empathized with the doves. He gnawed at the rope and set them free. All the doves cooed with gratitude. They flew away. The great queen said, "There's strength in unity," and set the elders away. Henceforth, the elders finally understood that together was more than just them. Together was beyond them. They reached out to the other communities beyond the walls, and a great bridge was built again. And the city of Babylon had prosperity and wealth for all its citizens and beyond. My name is Lady Dee Dee. You can find me at Lady Dee Dee Diamond Dee Dee on Instagram or wherever you'd like to. I love that you're here, and I really hope that you guys work together in harmony.
Oh, thank you, my love. Well, I'm really glad that we're on this in this conversation about interfaith, interspirituality, God optionality. We honor it all because these conversations we need to have in our communities and in our lives with our friends and families and coworkers and whoever will talk with us about them. I did rename this day Interfaith Day, and I am wearing green. Of course, my family is of Irish descent, but also my green, and all of us, I think we're in solidarity on this, our green represents Mother Earth, and so we celebrate spring coming. I want to take us deep for just a second. Will you go there with me?
Sure.
Okay, good, thank you. We faced some pretty awful things once again this week. We have witnessed yet another act of terrorism toward our Muslim friends, and as we know, over the past few years, there's been many attacks on different religious communities in our city here and across the world. I wanted to share and paraphrase just a tad from the official statement from my seminary that I went to, One Spirit Interfaith Seminary, Reverend Diane Burke leading it. And she had some really good things to say. I've put them in my own words, but she brings to our attention that several of these incidents have occurred. She recalls Mother Emanuel Church in Charleston and the Tree of Life in Pittsburgh. And of course, we added this week the Masjid al-Nur and Linwood mosques to this list of communities targeted with gun violence and terrorism. I want to ask you to think about this for a second. We call this church with a two-drink minimum, and I do advertise that it's God optional. And believe it or not, I get hate mail on Facebook for that. So the terror and the pain of the violence that people have, you know, gone through could happen anywhere, you know, and it could happen here. Somebody could come in with a crazy gun and kill us all because they're like, you know, God optional, no way. So this conversation is really important to me. And it's so easy, Diane shares with us, when faced with abject hate to respond in kind. We are outraged and heartbroken. We are. We're, of course we are. But the energy of anger and outrage must be transformed into passionate advocacy for recognizing the oneness of the entire whole human family and every other living being on earth. It's not just that are, it's not just humans. It's everything. We're a part of it all. So Reverend Diane says, we turn to the best natures of our hearts to express love for the victims. We hold each of them and their families within our circle of love. We cry out in pain for them, and we lift them up with our prayers of hope and healing, and that's exactly what we're doing right now. At a time when it's so easy to turn away, we stand firm in our belief that our work in the world is to bring comfort and care and peace. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
Thank you. Shalom.
Shalom.
Peace be among you and to all who are in pain. Jesus is quite all right with me. Buddha is quite all right. Oh yeah. Muhammad is quite all right with me. Abraham is all right. It's quite alright, oh yeah. Connection is quite alright with me. All of it is alright, yeah. Well, I don't care what path you take. Every path leads to the same place. We're living in sacred mysteries, grace. And all of it is alright, oh yeah.
science is quite alright, oh yeah. Atheist is alright with me, all of it is alright, yeah. Cause I don't care what path you take, every path leads to the same place. We're living in sacred history's grace, and all of it is alright, oh yeah. Gentlemen and others, we are proud to present to you right now an amazing song by an amazing person, Carly Oliva. Yay. I'm sorry, that was wrong. Carly Ozard Oliva.
Let's give it up again for Reverend Yolanda. So Reverend Glenn Ganaway chose this song for me, and this is before New Zealand happened, and now that we're in the aftermath, I don't think there's a better song to send across the ocean. There was a gentleman who stood outside with a sign that said, "I'll keep watch while you pray," and it went viral, and regardless of whether we live in a world where you can go viral or not, I think this song and what that man was trying to say unites together. And every time we can look into ourselves and ask, you know, if there's one more thing we can do that day, it's to make a safe passage for somebody who feels like they don't have one. Mm-hmm. So. Oh, why you look so sad? Tears are in your eyes. Come on and talk to me now. Don't be ashamed to cry. Let me see you through. Cause I've seen a dark side too. When the night falls on you, you don't know what to do. Nothing you confess could make me love you less. I'll stand by you. I'll stand by you. Won't let nobody hurt you. I'll stand by you.
They're very special friends of ours, and they came all the way from New Jersey, so it's an age birthday, so we come here.
Hi, y'all.
Wow, Carly, that was mind-blowing.
Yeah.
It truly, truly was.
It's here for the band as well.
Yeah, especially for the band. Sexy, sexy church, and sexy, sexy church, and sexy, sexy church, and sexy, sexy church, and woo! All right. Now, what church is complete without a preacher man? And we've got a preacher man for you. And he's actually the son of a preacher man, too. And I'm his Dusty Springfield. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Reverend Glenn Martin Ganaway.
Having a really bad day when I heard that song that Carly just sang, and Carly's voice was what I heard singing that song.
Yeah.
I hope you know somebody like that.
Like Carly?
Well, yeah, like Carly, certainly. Like Carly, but I have my back to this. Yeah. Don't make me. My name is Reverend Glenn Warren Ganaway, and I'm your favorite integral mentor. I am really glad that you are here. Interfaith is my jam, but apparently mic stands aren't. Who's heard of the Joseph Campbell's The Hero's Journey? Pretty familiar with this. Okay, lots of liberal arts education. The part of the hero's journey, that if you're familiar with the hero's journey, I'm going to talk about a very specific part of it. If in the very beginning you go from one rule to another, you go from one rule to the next, you go from what I'm calling what doesn't work into what does work. That is, I think, a really good way of understanding where we are in the culture right now. We are moving from one world to another world. Mm. We're moving from one paradigm that patently does not work to a paradigm that hopefully will work. And a lot of us don't even know what that is. The part of the hero's journey where that transition happens when we're moving from one place to another actually calls the guide forth. Mm. There's a guide that comes along. Maybe you know him as Gandalf. The guides in the wizard was a sort of guide in the Wizard of Oz, right? So it teaches you what you need to know. The guide is a really good metaphor for interfaith. The guide is a really good, the way I understand it, of understanding what interfaith, interspiritual, and God optional is. This guide that is specifically designed just for you. A specific guide that is your guide, not anybody else's guide. Well, this willingness we have to change worlds, to change our decisions, to listen to something new, brings about this new world, brings about the guide that we need. So let's talk about some definition of terms, because I'm also a good liberal arts education major. So definition of terms, let's call the journey the operating system. Let's call the operating system God. Let's call the guide the user manual.
Got that?
The operating system, the user manual. And what I call the user manual, I call it the voice that likes me. The ego is a virus in this metaphor. Maybe you would think of it as a frenemy. You know? Somebody who claims to have your best interest in mind. Do you know anybody like that? You probably watch as much television as I do. So, ACIM, A Course in Miracles, tells me about these voices. It tells me that there are two voices, and I'm a Course in Miracles person, so I'm going to use a couple of those lessons to illustrate this point, the points here today. The user manual shows us that we're not getting the results we want because of our ignorance of the operating system. Okay? I don't know about you, but I like reading owner's manuals. Used to make fun of me. I read the owner's manual from my phone. I mean, that's just what I do, you know, what I, you know. So I'm one of those people. I hope you will read the user's manual. The user manual tells us and shows us that we have the strength and ability we need for what is ours to do. The virus, the ego, tells us that we don't even need to read the user's manual. Figure it out.
That's right.
It goes in here somewhere. The virus is a parasite on the energy. And this parasite keeps us distracted, right, and in conflict. It would much more interested in our participation in conflict than it is in our ability to bring forth or express ourselves in the world. It has effects on our bodies too, and I think you know where I was going with this. The user manual feels calm and cool and collected. Right. Even if a lot of things are going on, if you're in the flow, you get that really good serious, like, this is all exciting and a lot of things are going on, but I'm kind of cool, calm, and collected inside. Mm-hmm. Right? So it doesn't have anything to do with out there. It has to do with what is ours to do. The virus feels frantic and fearful. The virus feels frantic and fearful. Their whole media empire is built on this idea of frantic and fearful ideas. Lesson 66 speaks to this directly. It says, what does the user manual say? What does the user manual actually say to you? And I was, the lesson 66 of A Course in Miracles speaks to this directly. It says, my happiness and my function are one. And I haven't always believed that. Has anybody ever told you that to follow your bliss?
Yeah. Yes.
Did you believe them? I know, uncomfortable laughter, right?
Sometimes.
Right. All of us are told that we need to pursue that in order to make a living. That's the virus. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. You get it?
Yep.
In order to be happy has nothing to do with your accumulation of assets. Mm-hmm. Okay? My happiness and my function are one. What are you here to do? We're part of a whole system and we're one thing. There's one earth. All of us is one. There's one life living. If those things are true, then you have a function and you're here to participate in a very specific way. You've heard me say this before, but I assure you, you are certainly ground down into peaks and valleys specific for this time and place that you need to accomplish, that we need you to step up and listen to this voice so that we're able to do what we are to do as a society. Our functions are your happiness is your function.
Right.
We pulled those things apart for ourselves. Well, our inner user's manual will tell us, if we consult it, what to do and where to go and what to say. It has access. That relationship has access and will tell us how we access all power and all knowledge in the world for what is yours to do. Ask specific questions. The virus tells us there is a very, very narrow expression of happiness. Think about that. A very narrow expression of happiness. You may know it with the phrase, you can never be too rich or too That's one way of saying it. Another way of saying it is there. I have not, is a. You can't have too many commas in your bank account. There's a very specific purpose that your usual manual will tell you how you can access all power in the world. Aaron, Mr. Patterson, I'm going to be coming to you here in just a minute. So that's your cue. Allison, I've got a cue here. I'm going to tell you a quick story. I went down a YouTube spiral yesterday. It was a good one. It was a good one. A bunch of singer-songwriters, young, angry, you know, let's change the world, you know, revolutionary, Phil Oaks, you know, just this YouTube spiral. You know, I was a mess. When Yolanda came home, she goes, what happened to you? There's like empty cookies, boxes, and tissues, and it's YouTube, and it's doing things. I went down this, and it got me in touch with that 20-something kid I was in the 80s. That two-bit hustler junkie shooting up in the basement in Kansas City with my friends talking about how we were going to save the world, how we were going to right all the wrongs in the world, how we were going to be the ones that were going to take down injustice and everything. Just how full of energy and anger and just all of it. Oh, and we were drinking beer and and getting arrested. And dying, right? It's the 80s. I watched my friends die from addiction because we aren't listening to that voice that likes us. Because I've had user manuals, I've had guides in my life that were external. I've had guides in my life that have been internal. But those guys in that basement saved my life. I was finally asking. I finally could actually be in a room and talk and let it all, and let myself and my expression come out in ways that I never even could fathom. And it was supported. Those people saved my life. Found the fairies, found Yolanda, found New York. The rest of the story you know, but this prayer from A Course in Miracles says it really well. Aaron, would you, very good friend of mine, Aaron Bettison, ladies and gentlemen, is going to read a prayer. If you could just stand there.
Okay.
Yeah, just sing it out, sister.
All right. Prayer for teachers, and I just wanted to say that it comes at a really good time with all the education scandals and the people who have lost the meaning of what education is.
Right.
Prayer for teachers. Holy are you, and in your light the world reflects your holiness. For you are not alone and friendless. I give thanks for you and join your efforts on behalf of God, knowing they are on my behalf as well, and knowing for all those who walk to God with me. And for all those who walk to God with me.
Thank you, Aaron. Amen. Very much.
Thank you, Aaron.
We're doing this together. We must be doing this together. That's what interfaith means. It means this guide that you have in it is a personal relationship with the divine, or with what is, or with what works. The world is changing. Mm-hmm. And we are going to build what is next.
Yeah. Yes.
We are strong enough and smart enough for the work that is ahead of us, no matter what the others are saying. But here's the deal. We're making a choice. The voice you listen to, either the virus or the user manual, your specific user manual, the voice you listen to will be the world we get. That's how important it is that you, we, us have a personal relationship with what works. You can call that Buddhism, Hinduism, you know, paganism, goddess worship, atheism, science. I don't care, integral. I don't care how it is that your mind works. There's a guide for you, and it's specifically designed for what you are to do in the world. Remember, it's very simple, to trust the voice that likes you. It'll tell you that we are one. And the best part is, it'll even tell you how to act like it. My name is Reverend Glenn Morton Ganaway. You are a charcoal tutor in Ganaway. Thank you, my love. Woo!
Well. So this is church, and we're going to take a love offering. How's that? Yeah. So usually, and next month, we will have candy samples with us, and most of the times when we do love offerings, we donate them to a cause. Next month, we're going to donate to the AIDS Walk, and then in May, we have something special too. But today, we really need to ask to donate to Bearded Lady Productions, which is creating this event. And if you can, just drop something in the red purse here that I'm going to hand to Dee Dee.
And
la-dee-da!
Yes, and thank you so very much. And if you would like to sing along with us, this is an offering song. What? Oh, so if you would also, a lot of our events are sponsored by our Patreon subscribers. And if you would like to be a part of our Patreon, it is patreon.com/REVYolanda. And we thank our Patreon supporters who are here today. Thank you so very, very much. You can have fun. And so, as Lady Dee Dee moves around the room, we're going to be singing a cute little song called I Love Myself. Shall we?
Thank you, my darling.
Responsibility and abundance flows through me, and I prosper.
Wow. Thank you so much for your love and support. We really appreciate it. And so now, I want to bring you into a little sing-along. How many kids? Well, how many were little kids? Some, at some point in life, you're a little kid sometime, right? Did you just pop out like an adult? B just popped out as an adult. That's okay. B and Winter over here are my favorite people. I love y'all so very much. But I wanted to do a sing-along that brings us back to Sesame Street.
Yay, Sesame Street!
Yeah, Sesame Street! I love Sesame Street. Okay, here we go. You'll know this one. Here we go. Thank you, Carolyn, for reminding me of this song. La 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 la. So I think we're doing that pretty well.
That was my cousin Tony that had to leave. I just wanted y'all to know he actually is my cousin, longstanding friend, somebody that has been closer to me than almost anybody else in my family. And he had to go to an appointment. But I want to cherish and celebrate all of you as my family. And thank you so much for being a part of our church and our community. And I want to thank Don't Tell Mama personally, Tanya and Sydney. Yay! For having us here and making our experience even better. Boy.
Yeah, baby.
Just really, you know, up to the experience for us. Thank you so much. Yay. And of course Allison on Life and Sound. And Randy is your server. So, we want to make a couple announcements. Carly, what you got going on? You got lots going on.
First of all, I want to thank my husband, Chris, for filming and taking pictures.
Yay! Oh, thank you, Chris. Yes.
If anyone needs a videographer, he's putting together his own business, Coco Vision. Yeah. And, he's cheaper than everybody else you hire. So, in more ways than one. Sorry. So, what I have going on.
What you got going on, girl?
All right, if you like free... Tuesday, Grand Central. I'm a Subway singer, and we're having a celebration for for Women's History Month. And basically, I'm singing from I think 3 to 6 in Grand Central with Music Under New York, representing Women's History Month. And if you want to come and sing a song and donate your money so I can live, that's kind of what that's about. And it's really fun, and I sing a lot of Adele and Mama Cass and everybody else that I look like that's more successful than me. And everything else coming up, if you go to my website, www.carlyozard.com, my album is for sale. On there, you can buy me on iTunes, you can get me on Amazon and CD Baby. I'm currently in the studio with my producer, Phil Carroll, working on 2 new songs. I'm totally drawing a blank, so check out my calendar, because I have no idea where I'm supposed to be. And I have a Patreon as well. And basically, it's the movement of global fusion EDM that's on the rise. Yeah. And it's basically getting everyone in the world to dance. Yes. And yes, and basically, that's what's going on with me. Oh, and Feathers and I are collaborating on a new track as well.
Well, thank you so much, Carly. We do want to hear from Feathers. This is Feathers, everyone. She, of course, is an amazing singer-songwriter. Today she's so graciously agreed to play bass with us. But tell us, Feathers, what's going on, please.
Hi, I'm Feathers. I just released an album called Let the Chaos Feed My Evolution. And that's kind of how I feel about the present moment. It's like, what can we do? Well, we can evolve through it, we can transcend, and we can transform it into art and just get closer to each other. Of course, the song's a little darker than that, but, you know. and it was produced by Phil. Through his wonderful nonprofit company, Recording Artist Development, who's brought me on as a producer as well. So I'm producing my first, producing these two wonderful queer artists through them, and just thrilled by the development, thrilled to be working with all these people, and I'm also performing tonight at the Poetry Brothel at the Back Room.
So, Poetry Brothel and Black Room?
The Back Room. The Back Room is on Norfolk Street, just north of the Essex stop.
It's behind the front room.
Yeah.
I'll throw myself out.
Anyway, that's what I have to
do.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. This is amazing. And you are going to feature her here at Minimum. But if you're curious as to what she does, go check her out tonight. This is so awesome. And Robin, do you have anything to share with us? How about you? No? Okay. You're just wonderful and amazing. Let's give Robin a round of applause.
And Phil is the producer of Recording Artist Development. Would you like to tell us a little bit?
Everybody covered everything.
Yeah,
so.
Yes. Okay, very good.
So much.
Phil Carroll, everyone. We have, Glenn and I, have a regular Wednesday night meeting and where we discuss A Course in Miracles. And many of our friends are in the room who attend. And if you'd like to join a very lively discussion about what works and what doesn't work in that virus and that user manual, talk to us after, and we'll give you directions to our event on Wednesday nights. Now, right after the show, we're going to hang out for a little social hour, just right outside this door. It's considered the piano bar still, right? Yeah. But we're gonna be behind the bar where all the, behind the piano, like right out here in front, where all the tables and chairs are, and we'd love to chat and talk, and if you'd like to, please stay and have a word with us and say hi. But I think that's about it. Yeah. Thank you for coming to church. And thank you for the room. Okay, this is our tradition at Church with a Two-Drink Minimum, our closing song. Some of you know it. And if you don't, you can very easily catch it. It's an easy song to sing. So join us if you like. Why do you feel so out of place? So out of touch with the human race? You don't seem why your brother won't lend a helping hand. Why do people tear apart? Ooh, your tender heart. Why does the night time seem so dark? When the light shines inside your heart.
Don't you see what